am going to use this text as the touchstone for my talk today. So take a good look at it, see if you can identify what it is and what it means. I'll even give you 6 of my precious 20 seconds for this slide, rather, to do that. If you guessed that my text was a basketball play,
oh, Carmelo.
Right, you're right. I suspect it might have been easier for you with these images for context. I wonder, though, how many of you would be confident coming up front right now to demonstrate this play? Don't worry, I won't. Much, that's true, you would actually can. Much of my research in the past 15 years has been grounded in the New London Group's theory of multiliteracies, particularly the idea that modes beyond the linguistic matter in meaning making. In this view, a text is the result of a creative design process using a range of semiotic resources. During that same 15 years, I've been teaching a required content literacy course. Of the 8 disciplines represented in the class, the K-12s, art, music, and physical education, have pushed my thinking most of all about what counts as a text and what that means for literacy instruction. A confession. When I first started teaching this course, I was steeped in a literature across the curriculum perspective, so the texts I recommended to PE majors were often sports-related fiction and poetry. Students liked those books, but they were, not surprisingly, pretty skeptical about their use in the gym. I began recommending that PE students consider short texts like this one, because they help kids learn vocabulary and context, see how ideas from PE play out in the world beyond school. Accessed online, they often included interactive multimodal features such as video clips or reader comments. Concerns still dog me about this second wave of text recommendations. Concerns that were validated by an emerging body of literature on disciplinary literacy that called for detailed investigation of skills and knowledge possessed by insiders who create and communicate within particular disciplines. But disciplinary literacy is focused on some disciplines more than others, as do many resources for teachers. Last year, New York mandated the EdTPA, an assessment requiring attention to academic language across all subjects. But even the bestseller by the EdTPA guru lacks examples beyond the so-called core 4. This gap in the literature sent me back to my roots as a teacher researcher. Enter Katie Kalinske, PE major, manager of the SU men's basketball team, who agreed to scaffold my play reading when I began to inquire into multimodal texts like this one that have been historically valued in PE. That slide that you've seen twice now is actually the first part of a 3-part play called The North Carolina Law, intended for use against the kind of 2-3 zone defense that SU famously plays. What I've realized, though, in making this slide, is how biased I still am toward print text conventions. This text has an author, Vaughn Reed, assistant women's basketball coach at SU. Because I found his play online, and frankly, because it was a play, it didn't immediately occur to me to credit him in the way I automatically would the author of a book or an article. And yet, think of how powerful it could be for PE students to connect Vaughn Reed and his multimodal text in a time when young black men are more often viewed as executors of plays than authors, and when the literature curriculum is still dominated by white people. When Katie and I examined the log play together, we created this list of basketball-specific academic language just from the 6 sentences accompanying those 3 diagrams. A print-centric version of text might have led us to stop there, but multiliteracy takes us further. We made a second list of academic vocabulary communicated graphically and visually by the text, words like he and shooting guard. Then we added terms that kids would need to access from their prior knowledge, such as offense and defense, in order to understand and run this play. This process hints at how complex this text is. Reading it well requires not just learning new content, including all that implicit and explicit vocabulary, but also being able to use that content in a multi-step sequence to embody it in 3-dimensional space.
Prior Alexa that, I dare you. The idea links to earlier work by Smith and Wellhelm's Reading, Don't Fix No Chevys, where they argued that many boys appreciate reading to do more than reading to learn. What's new here for me, though, is the role of what Vygotsky called the more capable other, coaches and conductors, in scaffolding that process. Unlike the vision of independent individual reading to learn enshrined in the Common Core, music and physical education have historically situated reading as a collective process, one where texts guide action and performance, not just cognition. To construct this insight, I needed a multiliteracies lens. Without it, I could not have identified the multiple modes in play, pun intended, with the basketball text. But I needed a disciplinary lens, too. I needed Katie's help to see how the elements of that text would work together in practice. Again, double meaning intended. Katie needed me, too. Although multiliteracies clearly aligns better with PE than a print-driven conception of text, she grew up and was schooled in a society where print reigned. At first, it was difficult for her to even see how her effortless reading of plays counted as literacy. Only when we engaged in dialogue did either of us realize the best way to honor PE's traditions while extending access to more learners might be to position kids as producers, not just consumers, of multimodal text. Enter whiteboards to write plays in the gym. Ditch the journals.